See, the objectives of my team are to create a path for leadership for electrification vehicles and for autonomous vehicles. And to create that path, we need technical development and technical innovation. We need to integrate that technology with the more traditional vehicle technology. And when we need to modify one or the other to make those work, we obviously do that. And in reality, create exciting, customer-focused, leading-edge products that will help GM transform from the more traditional model that most people associate the automotive industry with to where we think the product and the industry is going. As part of that innovation, we are partnering differently than we have in the past. So for instance, we acquired a company called Cruise Automation about 18 months ago, and we're using, it's a startup in the San Francisco area, we're funding that and enabling it to help us transform. There's several factors driving the strategy. I would say there's competitive pressures. I would say there's regulatory pressures, although those tend to change, at least in North America, depending on the political climate. But one of the things I'm really excited about is recently, we've talked about this internally for a while, but now we're starting to go public, where Mary and Dan and Mark, Mary Barra, Dan Ammon, Mark Royce, are talking about the way we see the future, the way General Motors sees the future. And we talk about zero crashes, we talk about zero emissions, we talk about zero congestion. And you may say, wait a minute, that's kind of way out there. Really, zero crashes, zero emissions? But what I love about it is it's a simple vision and it's a kind of a crystallizing vision. Because if you see the world like that, and when that's going to happen, we're not sure. How fast, we're not sure. But if that's the way we see the world, then that's where we're driving the business. And so you start to invest in things that maybe don't have a short-term return because they support that part of the business. And you start to look at technology that enables those things, and you start to develop business models that enable those things. I think one of the big barriers is price. Until we're able to make money on electric vehicles at the same price as we sell gas-powered vehicles, I think that will become a barrier. And so we're working very hard on the cost side of that, because once we get past that, I think people will love electric vehicles. Along with price and cost is range, right? You can get a lower cost, lower price vehicle, but it may have less range than the customer's used to. People are very used to 300, 400, maybe even 500 miles on a tank of gas. Well, probably they're going to expect to buy a car for the same price for about the same range, number one. And then number two, they're going to have to fill it up. So the charging infrastructure and the way we charge the products, I think, is another big barrier. And I think there's a lot to be done there. And I'm not sure General Motors is going to do that on its own, but I think it's key to enabling the transition to electric vehicles. We are in electric vehicle space. We've done several vehicles. We did the original EV1 some years ago before anybody was ready for it. We did the Volt Gen 1. We've done a Volt Gen 2. We actually did a Spark electric vehicle. We've now done the Bolt, and we're very proud of the Bolt. For under $30,000, you can get a car that goes 238 miles, terrific little car. It's selling quite well. We're very proud of that. And we're creating what we started to announce as platforms of multiple entries of electric vehicles, not just one car, but CUVs, SUVs, platforms of vehicles for a much wider offering. And that you're going to start to see that in really the next 3, 4, 5, 6 years, that's really going to start to hit. The other area which might even happen potentially quicker than electric vehicle significant adoption is what I would call autonomous, and specifically in the rideshare space. So in the major cities, and it's part of reducing congestion, reducing emissions in the cities, and providing mobility, it's kind of a terrific solution in the middle of that space. May not be the best or only, but at least for now, we see it as a terrific solution where we can provide mobility at a very low cost while creating zero emissions, having a dramatic improvement on the safety of these vehicles. I believe 94% of all crashes we see are human-related. So, sensors don't get tired and don't get distracted, and you know, sensors don't check their cell phones, and all of these things that we as humans tend to do. So when you think about autonomous rideshare, it kind of clicks all three of our major objectives. And frankly, I think it's sooner than people think. Everyone knows about Ubers and Lyfts. Took a Lyft here this morning. It's a great thing that came out of several other technologies, and the business model was created. I think that model probably won't stay the same and could be disrupted. And I think autonomous rideshare is one of the things that could disrupt it. So maybe from a customer standpoint, it's the same experience or mobility solution, but the way it's done is a lot different.